Radio presents The Truth Denied, Talk Radio, with your host, Roxy Lopez, where truth never lies. If you would like to speak with Roxy on the air, the call-in number is 347-327-9997. Here she is, your host, Roxy Lopez.
Good afternoon. This is Roxy Lopez with the Truth Denied Talk Radio. How's everybody doing today? I know that we have a huge, huge amount of people interested in this show. Today, our guest is Rosalind Peterson. And I must say, speaking with Rosalind about a week ago, I got so much information. And her website is extensive. And for those of you who want to take a look at the website while we're on the air, it's agriculturedefensecoalition.org. And in 1995, Rosalind, who is now retired, became a certified Californian United States Department of Agriculture, which is the USDA, Farm Service Agency Agriculture Crop Loss Adjuster. Boy, that's a mouthful. She worked in more than 10 countries throughout California, counties throughout California. Many crop losses throughout this, the state can be attributed to weather-related causes. Now, she worked for 5 years for the Mendocino County Department of Agriculture as an agriculture technologist before being hired by the USDA Farm Service Agency in California. Today, Rosalind is the California president and co-founder of the Agriculture Defense Coalition, the ADC. And the ADC was formed in 2006 to protect agriculture from a wide variety of experimental weather and atmospheric testing programs. Rosalind also founded the California Sky Watch. I know a lot of you are familiar with California Sky Watch, in 2002. And when she began researching atmospheric testing and weather modification programs, that's when she started. The two websites are separate entities but are linked together by issues listed alphabetically in the category section. So if you're on that website, pay attention to that. The California Sky Watch website is merging permanently are already merged with the ADC at this point. So let's welcome Rosalind Peterson to the show. Rosalind, good morning, and thanks for coming to the show.
Oh, you're very welcome, and it's an honor and a privilege to be here. Do you have your producer check your output? Because I'm getting about 4 out of every 7 words say,
hello?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, and you're cutting out as well.
Yes, it's not, we're not getting, words are missing.
Okay. Yeah, you know, every now and then this happens. Now, can you hear me at all again? Sorry to the audience and sorry to Rosalind.
That's okay, I cannot hear every word that thing.
Okay. Rosalind, I don't know. Your phone's also cutting out for us. That's what the engineer is saying. And then on my side, you know, we've been having technical difficulties before the show. So, and it's making it very aggravating for both of us. I don't know if we can get through the show with all of this happening. What do you think, Rosalind?
My phone is a line, so it shouldn't be cutting out. I've not experienced this before at all, except when I've been on Skype, where callers have called me from Skype.
Okay.
Sometimes that's a difficulty.
Right. And I want to say the issues are with Skype at this point, because I'm having the same difficulty, and I'm going through Skype as well from the show. And we can't seem to solve. You are definitely cutting out for me. and I'm cutting out for you, correct?
That's correct. I'm not getting words that you say.
Okay. I'm going to have to say that I don't think that you and I can do this show today, Rosalind, not with this kind of hang up. And if we aren't able to sort it out, we're just going to definitely have to reschedule the show. And this is really unfortunate because you and I have worked very hard for this show today. I don't know that you and I can do a whole 2 hours like this.
Well, we can try calling from the studio.
Okay. We've got...
Hello?
Yes. Bernard just said we're going to try calling from the studio instead and see if we can't clear some of this up.
Okay.
And, yes, I've got some major issues on this side as well. But if we've allotted the time, let's see what we can do. Okay, he's saying to tell you to hang up, and he's going to call you from a different number. Okay, thanks, Rosalind. And for everybody else, we're still rolling on the air here. So let's see if we can't get the expertise of Bernard Alvarez here. See if we can't try to clear this up. We've also had phone problems all week long. And in the meantime, I've got a very large echo on my side, which makes it really difficult for me to talk. But just hang in there, people. We have a very important show. Okay. So we're getting a busy signal from Rosalind, and Rosalind let us know before the show that her phone has been going out, her ground line. Different people have been calling her. They get a busy signal when she's not on the line. And, of course, you heard her cutting out as well. On my end, we've also had major phone problems. Okay, now we're getting a ringing.
Hello.
Hi, Rosalind.
Hi, how are you? You sound better.
I do.
Much better.
Okay. Now,
are you better? Can you hear me?
Roxy, why do I call you on your cell phone?
All right. That's
okay. Let me call you on your cell phone. You can hang up your Skype as soon as we get you on cell phone.
Thank you. Okay, Rosalind, hang in there.
Okay. I'm sorry.
No, don't worry about it. This happens. It just means it's a really important show.
That's probably true.
Okay, hold on. I see. Okay, hold on.
Hello there.
Yes, I'm here.
Hello?
Yes, I'm here.
Yep, we're all there.
Okay, we're all here. Okay, are we all still on the air?
Yeah, we're on the air, and there's no problems. It looks clear.
Okay, great. Okay, so we took the middleman Skype out, and now we're going to have a show. Roz, let's start this over again, Rosalind. My goodness, I hope people are waiting through this. I think they will be. We figured it out. Thank you very much, Bernard Alvarez. He solved the issue, and now we can have a show again. Rosalind, welcome to the show. Good morning. You sound a lot better. You're not cutting out. And
you're not cutting out either.
Yay! Okay, we did this. Excellent. Now, Rosalind, where should we begin? Because I did give a background, and I think on the air that some of the information that I gave to the listeners, I don't think it was cutting out to the listeners. I hope it wasn't. But you have sent me quite a bit of documentation, which I'm, you know, absolutely impressed with. Always been impressed with your work. It's also an honor to have you on the show. So let's get to it. For the listeners, I have one question I want to ask at the front of the show for you. And then later on, at the hour mark, We're going to invite a couple of people to, come on. Aldis Chico from Kingsman has a report along with Steve Mallon, and they're going to call in the show with that and run something by you. And then, of course, it'll be open to callers to call in and ask you some questions. Now, I have to tell you something pretty funny. Some people wrote in and they had some questions, and I do have them for you for later, much later in the show. But they said that quite a few people had said that they really looked up to you and they really looked up to your work, and you were their just an iconic figure for them, for the amount of information that they have gotten off your website. And they said they were too scared to call in. And I said, don't be scared. Rosalind's not going to bite you. But they just revere you so much. And they said, can you just ask her a question? So know that about the listening audience, that you are revered and for your work. So we all appreciate you. And one of the questions that keeps coming up over and over again, Rosalind, and I think you'd be very efficient at answering this question. What are we seeing being sprayed in our skies? What are these white lines, these X's, these huge contrails that spread out into massive cloud formations? What are you finding that we are looking at? What is this?
Well, I think it would be easier if I just backtrack just a little bit. I worked for the United States Department of Agriculture for many years, both at the state level and at the county level. And as a crop loss adjuster, where I traveled about 50,000 miles a year, determining crop losses for the state of California, if someone had a tomato loss or a grape loss, any type of loss, we would go and determine why there were crop losses and then figure out the financial loss amounts, things like that. So what happened was that most of the losses were weather-related for the most part. And then in 2002, I began to be aware that the skies here in Mendocino County in Northern California, where I live, began to be filled with jet contrails that persisted for hours. They turned into man-made clouds. There was different types of plumes. There was circles and cross hatches and loops and jets, big jets, flying around this county constantly. And we began to notice that these plumes would obscure the amount of direct sunlight reaching the earth. It was like dimming the sun. And I began to be concerned for a variety of reasons. One, it wasn't normal. And two, the skies in dimming the sun were going to have an impact on the amount of direct sunlight reaching the earth. This would directly impact crops, because when you take away direct sunlight, you lower the amount of photosynthesis that all plants and trees, everything that grows, need in order to, for example, produce a crop. Trees needed to grow healthy and strong. And I began to see this in the skies more and more, where weeks would go by and we'd have either a covering of white haze or we'd have these man-made clouds, and the jets would be renewing this procedure every day, so that very seldom did we have the clear, deep blue skies that we used to see. This is true through today. And at that point, I started doing research to figure out, in 2002, what was happening, what was the history, what was going on that was going to impact not only solar power panel production because of a lack of direct sunlight, but crops, trees, plants, anything that depended on direct sunlight to produce the energy they needed to grow. So my research project started with California Skywatch, and I started putting up my research information on that website. And for almost 10 years, this April, all of my research, except for just really recent items, which I haven't had time to put online, are up online on the agriculturedefensecoalition.org website. And the category section I will be speaking from The categories section is an alphabetical listing of all the documents, studies, research that I have done for about 10 years. So when I start speaking today about the issues about what's going on in the skies, I want everyone to know that I'm going to stay within the limits of not speculating, but I'm going to talk about what I can prove from the research. So in answer to the question, many people ask me all the time what the jets are spraying, and the answer is, I don't know. I know it sounds strange, but if I could break this story in any way possible, I would. And right now I can tell you that I have no idea. I do know that the military, the U.S. military, delivers into the atmosphere about 500 tons of aluminum-coated fiberglass particulates called chaff, and that interferes with radar and can track weather patterns when it floats in the air for about 20 hours sometimes. So it moves around above us and is used for military applications. This has been studied by various congressional hearings at various times. There are related and associated health effects, and that's on the U.S. Navy and the U.S. Air Force section of the website. Without saying much more, I can tell you that jet fuel emissions are very, very toxic, that exposure to jet fuel emissions can impair memory, can cause crop damage, increase asthma, and has other health effects. So we do know that the plumes are not just made up of ice crystals and water vapor, that they're made up of jet fuel emissions, which are highly toxic. But as far as I know, there's no jet fuel that has any aluminum particulates or barium particulates within it. So I cannot tell you that the jets are releasing those two chemicals which most people ask about. Now, as far as rocket programs, the United States Air Force, the United States Navy, and NASA have many, many rocket programs, along with the space shuttle, which has stopped flying. But the space shuttle fuel and rocket fuel contain aluminum particulates because it's a different kind of hot combustion that's needed for burning to get the rockets up into the atmosphere. And we're exposed to that all the time. The U.S. Navy and the U.S. Air Force have conducted a wide variety of chemical releases and other atmospheric experiments where aluminum oxide dust clouds are sprayed into the skies, where they've used barium, aluminum, strontium, sulfur hexafluoride, called SF6, lithium, and other chemicals that they use for atmospheric experiments. There is so many documents on this subject backing up what I've just said that I can't even get it all on the website, because there are so many of them talking about the experiments, the university studies, the type of experiments they're doing. They advertise quite readily on the NASA website, for example, or the Navy advertises these programs. They're not hiding it, and we are being exposed when these particles and chemicals reach the Earth. And these are rocket programs. As far as what the jets are doing, I can't find any piece of legitimate research which could give us the answer.
Right, and neither can any of us who are involved in looking into the deeper layers of this, although I tend to agree with you about the countless PDF files, studies, universities, Livermore Labs, the CARE, C-A-R-E from NASA. That was an interesting one. Can't find anything about the actual spraying. I agree with you. And our debunkers will say that there are no sprayers on the plane and they aren't spraying anything. And, you know, go back to the ice crystal, scenarios. And I had a gentleman named Mark McCandlish on the show, who's an aviation expert. And he was saying that, I mean, and you can answer to this, he was saying that there is aluminum oxide in jet fuel. It's to propel a plane, so a plane can go faster. And I'm not using the right language, but he was saying that aluminum oxide is in jet fuel. And do you know anything about that?
No, I don't. But here's the problem. JP4 is jet fuel that's used by commercial airlines, and it was tested in a laboratory on the Discovery Channel program back in 2007. They did get a regular sample of JP4, and they tested it, and there was no aluminum in it. The military has classified what they put into their JP8, JP10, JP5 fuels, and they won't release the data of what's in it. So it would be hard to know, although most people that I've talked to within the military from time to time have said that they wouldn't suspect that it would be in there, that aluminum particulates would not be in there because the jet engine, the ramjet, might not be able to handle it. But I can't go any further than that. I don't know for a fact.
I may send you, after the show, a couple of documents you might want to look at if you have the time. It might open your eyes to another dimension of this, if you will. He gave a full argument for why it is, and you know, like you say, you don't comment too much outside of the area of your own expertise, and I can appreciate that. When CBS interviewed me, they asked me the same question, and they asked me, if I've ever personally tested, you know, anything that's up there coming out of a plane, and I said no. And I couldn't prove. I answered the question the same way you did. So what we can't prove, we have to be careful. And I appreciate that about you, that you stay within the area of your expertise, which brings me to my next question. You brought up with me when we were on a discussion on the phone a week ago or so with the Navy. Now, a couple of programs with the Navy, the military. And I'm happy to see something else that you sent to me. This is really good news in regarding the Seattle groups, the conservationists and Native American tribes that are suing the Navy's expanded use of sonar in training exercises in Washington, Oregon, and California. Can you speak a little bit more about that, what's going on there, and why this is such great news as well?
Yes, the U.S. Navy, since 2007, has been working very hard to put together 16 five-year warfare testing programs centered in the Atlantic, the Pacific, and the Gulf of Mexico. Each of these range complexes, what they call them, have initiated five-year warfare testing programs where they can have live bomb blasts, sonar testing, all kinds of new weapon systems training and testing to see how they work. And within each of these programs, it's a different area of the United States. For example, the Northwest Training Range Complex, which you just referenced, covers the area of Northern California, Oregon, Washington, and Idaho. It's a huge range. And during the course of time, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, gave a permit to the Navy to test every single solitary weapon system that they wanted to in our most biologically sensitive areas, in our national marine sanctuaries, marine reserves, and any other area they wanted to test without restriction, knowing that it would fully well cause the harm to millions of marine mammals, not only in our range, but in the range, the Southern California range, which is a separate five-year warfare program for testing, and in other areas of the United States, all along the coastal regions. There's hardly a coastal region now which doesn't have a five-year warfare testing environmental impact statement. The lawsuit that was just initiated on January 26th by Indian tribes all the way from Northern California, Mendocino County, where I live, all the way up through Oregon and the state of Washington, have filed a lawsuit against NOAA for granting the Navy a permit to test without any restrictions whatsoever sonar. And this is experimental sonar as well as sonar that has been tested before without any restrictions on where, when, how, for how long. And if it's experimental sonar, being that there's been no studies, that they're testing just for the sake of testing, they have no idea what impact this would have on marine mammals, fish, and other aquatic organisms.
How long have, with your understanding, how long have they been testing this type of sonar? How many years? Or is it something
sonar
new?
Sonar has been used for a long time, going back to World War II. But the thing about sonar is that now they've got, it's much more sophisticated. There's different levels. And that the sonar testing used to be in just a few areas in the ocean. Now it's in every ocean area of the Pacific, the Atlantic and the Gulf of Mexico, including the Marianas Islands in the Pacific, the Hawaiian Island area. There's a five-year range between the Southern California range and Hawaii. There's a huge range for testing in the Gulf of Mexico, which was recently approved. And there's ranges all along the eastern seaboard of the United States. The 16 ranges will harm more than 11.7 million marine mammals, according to Senator Barbara Boxer and Senator Dianne Feinstein. Several other senators and my congressman, Mike Thompson, have also signed letters to that effect as well.
I remember you bringing up Hawaii. That's where I'm from. And I don't remember the year, but it was definitely within the last decade. There was a huge issue in Hawaii with the sonar testing. And for a couple of years there, the tuna, which is, you know, that's a huge industry in Hawaii, were starting to swim up north, ending up in California, you know, colder water, and they're warmer water fish. And, you know, basically leaving the area. And my brother, who was a tuna fisherman at the time, was saying that, you know, their seasons were just reduced because either the fish weren't there or they were dead, one or the other. They were having complete failure in fishing expeditions. Another one is my husband is a deep sea fisherman. And for the past year, Rosalind, and I've been really documenting this, there is something going on, you know, out of Dutch Harbor, about 200 miles out where they fish, 200 to 250 miles out of Dutch Harbor, Alaska. They went out two seasons in a row for cod, and one of them was black cod, was last March, and roughly 87 boats caught no black cod for 3 months during the entire black cod season. And for instance, the captain on my husband's boat has been doing this for 40 years. My husband's been deep sea fishing for 25 years. A lot of the guys on the boat have been working for that long as well, roughly 20 years, two decades. And none of them have explanations. They don't know where the fish went. And they haven't experienced that in their entire careers. So this was simultaneous, by the way, last year in March, to some events that seemed to happen on the coast of, I believe, California and Oregon. We ran a report on the one in California where there were millions of fish showing up dead on the beaches of Southern California. And I believe that they were showing up all the way up the coast of Oregon and Washington, but not in the amounts that were showing up in California. And when I did a little investigating on that, that fish, I believe it was the krill, was something that the cod eat. And so with mass die-offs like this, do you think that that might be associated with either geoengineering programs or sonar programs? Have you been able to put your finger on it?
Well, I haven't been able to put my finger on it because there's a massive cover-up that every time you have one of these stranding events or dead fish showing up, they say, well, it's a tide or it's this or that. They have about 100 excuses, but whenever you ask them, well, is this associated with the U.S. Navy warfare testing, they don't even ask the question. It's like it's an untouchable. The press doesn't want to touch it. No one wants to touch it. But I can tell you from in other words, Mexican border all the way along the Pacific Ocean, all the way through Washington, there's massive testing going on of weapon systems. And I list a lot on my website. If you go to categories under U.S. Navy, and then you go into the U.S. Navy section, you can look at the maps, the U.S. Navy maps, and you can see where they're conducting their tests right now, plus the Marianas and the Hawaiian Islands and other areas. And I can tell you that they're using hazardous materials. They're using bomb blasts all along the coast. They're using missile exercises, sonar exercises. They even have new types of testing that they're doing. The exposure to underwater bomb blasts, missile exercises, toxic chemicals from the exercises that they use, and the type and air-to-air missile exercises, and they talk about in the environmental impact statement for each one of these ranges, of which I think I have all but one on my website at this time, so you can look at them. But under hazardous materials, they talk about the number and scope of the missile live fire exercises that they're doing, the bomb blast. They admit that they will impair and impact marine mammals on these. And they list all of these different types, the poundage, how many, hundreds of them, hellfire missile exercises, the whole thing. These are exploding underwater, just above the surface of the water. The military exercises also include the use of sonar, new types of sonar, new types of laser weapon systems. The whole thing is being tested off almost the entire California coastline, all of Oregon, and all of Washington. And with this massive program extending out into the ocean areas with their new five-year warfare ranges, there is no doubt that this has to be a decimation of the marine mammals in the areas.
And I guess the question of the day would be for me and millions of people, as a matter of fact. First of all, thanks for explaining what you just did, because this isn't showing up in our mainstream media. That's another thing. You're right. The media won't touch it. They're not exposing this, which is really unfortunate, because most people don't even know it's really going on unless they see it for themselves, or unless somebody called them and showed them a video or let them know that it's going on. And then a lot of people don't even believe that it's going on, or that, like what you just said, they sort of cover it up by saying, oh, it's just a little thing that happens every 20 years, or cyclical things, or, you know, when millions of animal life die. Do you recall...
Go ahead.
Oh, do you recall last January in Arkansas what happened there with the, I believe it was 5,000 birds crashed to the ground? I don't know if you remember the story at all.
Yes.
And hazmat came out and took all the birds, and they said it was like a digestive, you know, they overate. That was their first report that the birds over ate, and that's why they crashed to the ground, which was insanity. Have you looked into that story at all, and some of the fish that died in the Ozark, have you, in the river? Have you looked into any of that to make any correlation with some of what you're talking about with, you know, this laser technology going on in the air?
It's hard to know because the Navy doesn't, and the Air Force and these different military groups don't tell you where they're going to be testing at any given time. They just conduct the tests, and usually you, sometimes, but not always, you can find out much later. Other times you'll never find out at all because they don't want you to know that they're doing it. So to correlate this, I can speculate only that it could be some of the Air Force or the military, U.S. Navy programs, but it's really hard to prove. And with the press,
and you had
not,
a thought before, yes. If you wanted to expand on a thought that you and I kind of butted on, like, you want to go ahead? Go ahead and talk about your thought.
Well, my thought, there was two thoughts. One is that the major media won't cover the story. It's like this is a poison dart pen. They know it exists only because I have sent the U.S. Navy maps to all of the major MSNBC and 4, 5, 7, 2, and only KTVU Channel 2 out of Oakland, San Francisco will cover the story. As far as the major newspapers in California, they won't touch it. As far as any of your elected officials actually being willing to do a press comment, no, they won't do it, except for my Congressman Mike Thompson. But senators wrote a letter on June 17, 2009, and the letter is on my website. You can go to the NOAA letter for June 17, 2009. And part of it reads, in effect, in many regions, the Navy plans to increase the number of its exercises or expand the areas in which they may occur, and virtually every coastal state will be affected. Some exercises may occur in the nation's most biologically sensitive marine habitats, including national marine sanctuaries and breeding habitats. In all, the Navy anticipates more than 2.3 million takes. Significant disruptions in marine mammal foraging, breeding, and other essential behaviors per year, or 11.7 million takes over the course of a five-year permit. A take means killing, harming, exposing to toxic chemicals, anything you can imagine, including outright killing them. The thing is that they never talk about fish because the Navy never had to do an environmental impact statement about the harm to fish. So they don't even have to discuss it or acknowledge it because they never had to do any testing on this. And the last thing I want to say, this is from my Congressman Thompson. He wrote a letter on October 8th, 2010, just before they were going to approve testing in the Northwest Training Range, which is Northern California, Oregon, Washington, and Idaho, to expand their testing. And he writes, quote, in that earlier letter, I objected to the Navy's intention to proceed with the EPA process while the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration was still in the process of conducting a comprehensive review of sonar impacts on marine mammals. The review found that protecting important marine mammal habitats is generally recognized to be the most effective mitigation measures currently available. Yet, without providing any specifics about why the Navy requires completely unrestricted flexibility to use any and all parts of the Northwest Training Range complex, in its final environmental impact statement, the Navy has flatly rejected proposals to consider limiting its activities in specific areas to reduce the impact on marine mammals or other species or habitats. I find it unacceptable that the Navy will not even consider some restrictions on its activities to reduce its potentially significant, but in many cases largely unknown, impact on marine resources.
It's so irresponsible. And how are they getting the I'm going to ask a question that has an obvious answer, but I'll let you answer it. How are they getting approval to do any of this? Is it falling under experimentation? Is it falling under... How are they getting the approval to run with all of this?
The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration is just approving and has approved all of these five-year warfare training programs, the 16 of them, to be accurate right at this moment. And all 16 either are in the approval process, and many of them have already been given approval by NOAA to go ahead with the testing. And they're rubber stamping it, even though that they know that marine mammals will be harmed, that it could break down the fisheries, the bomb blasts could destroy the habitats. All of these things they know, and they also know that in every one of the 16 warfare testing ranges, the same exact training and testing and use of toxic chemicals and bomb blasts and all of this is going on. So the training is not just one area for the purposes of experimentation. It is training that is taking place in every single ocean area and island area surrounding the United States.
NOAA is turning to be such a powerful giant now, it looks like.
Yes, it is, and that's why
I don't think they
important.
Were ever intended. I don't think they were ever intended to be this powerful, nor our military for that matter. It's really disturbing. And again, for those of you who are listening, please go to Rosalind's website. And again, under categories, and I'm on her website right now and looking at some of what she is speaking about. It's very easy to peruse, very easy to find the tab, categories. It's right in the middle to the right. And go ahead and click that so that you can simultaneously be reflecting on what Rosalind is talking about here, what she's sharing with us. Very well organized here. And again, I'd also urge people to share this information with others. It's extensive information and findings, and like what Rosalind is, you know, like what you're reporting, Rosalind, it's, these are facts. And I've also come across so much of this as well. And when I see, I just find it blatant, for instance, NASA's website. So easy to, really, you don't have to do much digging to come across, let's say, the CARE rocket. You know, I believe that was 2009, wasn't it?
Yes, that one experiment was 2009, and CARE is
right.
Charged.
You want to
go
into a little bit more? Go into a little bit more detail about that program, what they actually did in 2009, because that's stunning information.
Yes, what they did in 2009, the United States Navy. In conjunction with NASA, they used a NASA Black Brant rocket. As a matter of fact, on my website, I even have the Navy was so proud of this that they even showed how they did it and what they did in the sky that night. And it was seen, the rocket was seen all the way from Florida all the way to Maine. And they created an aluminum oxide dust cloud. They released this aluminum oxide dust cloud across on September 19, 2009, across the entire eastern seaboard of the United States in order to conduct different types of atmospheric and other experiments, knowing fully well that this aluminum oxide particulates would come back down to Earth at some point, polluting the oceans and the land areas.
And they didn't have a follow-up to that program at all, do you think?
I think that they decided they weren't going to make it public because they made it public thinking it was going to happen a week before. The weather was so bad they couldn't do it. So when we got a hold of this program, we began to talk about it. They began to have opposition to the program. So I think the Navy is reticent about making public subsequent programs because of the fallout that they had from this particular one.
And for those listening also under categories, you can look under NASA for a lot more information actually on some of the programs, some of what NASA experiments are up to. And I do find it interesting, once again, that you can find a lot of this stuff on the Internet, you know, through NOAA, through NASA, through the Navy, for that matter. But Rosalind has done us a huge service and put this all on her website, again, alphabetical order under categories, so that it's much easier. She's taken the footwork out for you, for the listeners. Wow. A tremendous amount of information, to which it's starting to look like the Bible of environmental information here. But yeah, it's alarming, and it is interesting. I didn't discover the CARE rocket program until about a year ago. So it was long after it had occurred already. And I was just absolutely shocked, and I haven't seen a follow up to it. Are you doing testing as well? Are you still doing testing with like rainwater or anything in agriculture or soils?
I rarely do any testing myself because the data wouldn't hold up for any type of evaluation, because someone say, well, you put something there to get a result or whatever. I use the data from the California State Department of Health Drinking Water Division, which tests for aluminum and barium and a lot of these chemicals in drinking water. And I also rely on the Air Resources Board here in California. They do a bit of aluminum testing. So I can have their own tests, and I can use the data showing that we are having unusual spikes in these particular chemicals. I've also put a listing on the aluminum section of all the sources of aluminum that I could find in upper atmospheric testing being done. I did the same for barium. And some of the older documents are better because they explain the purpose of the tests. And they also give you a complete listing of the chemicals being used, which is not so much the case in recent years, because they don't want to talk about what they're doing as much, or the explanation is pretty simplistic rather than being a real detailed explanation that the public could really understand.
Mm-hmm. I see at the top of your list is the wells back feeding. And which is, you know, that patent, which seems to be the focus for a lot of us. I mean, that wells back patent. And for those listening, if you do not know or not aware of that patent, it's also on our website. You need to look into that wells back feeding patent. I mean, this is what I think is highlighted in some of the experimentation going back to geoengineering. And let's go back to another question would be, I guess, programs like CARE under NASA, and then other geoengineering programs that most people are identifying as chemtrails, what they're identifying as these white checkerboards and X's and artificial clouds, if you will, formations. Would you say that that's a military experiment as well?
Yes. I think that there's a lot of military experiments going on. And for example, David Keith, now used to be at Calgary University, but now he's at Stanford, is promoting the use of aluminum oxide and water vapor mixed together to form particles. And he's talking about using a small fleet of planes to put an aluminum oxide dust cloud up into the atmosphere about, we're talking megatons, two, three, four megatons every year worldwide in order to reduce the amount of direct sunlight reaching the Earth. Well, the U.S. Navy is already engaged with their rocket program releasing aluminum oxide. The Air Force releases trimethyl aluminum and does experiments with trimethyl aluminum. There's all kinds of programs going on already. So to say that we're going to add more particles and chemicals like sulfur, aluminum oxide, release them into the atmosphere to reduce the amount of direct sunlight, the geoengineering is already taking place because we're reducing the amount of direct sunlight in three ways. We've got the jets producing the man-made clouds and the haze, which restrict direct sunlight from reaching the Earth. That's already ongoing. So the jets themselves have an impact, according to NASA and Stanford University studies, in that these contrails producing man-made clouds change the weather and the climate. They also, the jets in leaving the vapor trail, that's water vapor, it's a greenhouse gas, so the clouds trap the heat in, especially in the Arctic and Alaska areas, creating a melting effect via aviation impacts. That's going on. And so now you're talking about these geoengineers who want to reduce more of the direct sunlight reaching the Earth by putting more of these chemicals into our atmosphere that they tell you will come back down, will cause acid rain, that will harm our trees and our plants, that will pollute our air, our water, and our soils. And so I look at this as a wide range of programs that are already being implemented and underway. And then we have these geoengineers under the guidance of solar radiation management trying to make the particles in the sky more reflective so that they, and the clouds, using salt particles, by the way, which when rained out also pollute our fresh water supplies and our soils, making them unproductive. But they're talking about putting all these things into the atmosphere in order to reduce the amount of sunlight. Well, we're already having that effect. We have a lack of vitamin D from not enough sunlight reaching the Earth so that it's not absorbed through the human skin and the health effects related to that, which is on the vitamin D section of my website. We're reducing solar panel power production because of lack of sunlight when you have the jets producing these man-made clouds and haze. We do know that that's happening in some of the sunniest and hottest areas in Northern California and other areas. So we're having this tremendous impact of geoengineering, which it falls under anything that you're doing to the atmosphere, artificially changing the atmosphere around us for experimentation purposes. That's exactly what we're engaged in. And I talk about that in two sections on geoengineering. One is a current events section where you can read about the definitions, see my PowerPoint presentation, and also see one of the recent presentations I did back in October last year where I talk about this issue, the jets and geoengineering programs. And then you can go to the other section, which talks about schemes, and it talks about all of the different ideas, some of which are already implemented, some are going to be implemented in the future, or as we speak, they're thinking about implementing some right now. All of that information is on the website so that you can get almost everything I know about geoengineering that I can find, plus speeches of different people talking about it are on the website.
Which is excellent. And we'll talk about that PowerPoint presentation that you did in October of 2011, I believe. I did watch that. It's for those who haven't seen it, I believe if you go to the website, isn't it located right on the front page of your website, of agriculturedefensecoalition.org?
It's on the geoengineering section. And it's
okay,
on the current events section of geoengineering, and that's where my latest presentation is. On California Skywatch, on the homepage, there's, and that's californiaskywatch.com on the homepage, there's another program, first one, that I do when I talk about all of these programs, weather modification, geoengineering, the jets. I talk about that as well. So there's a couple of places where you can find information that I talk about.
Yes, it's this is a massive website, people. So get on it, start looking at it. Again, it's agriculture defense coalition.org, and we will be making a video of this show as we do, and downloading the audio of this show. And Rosalind has also sent some photos in and a lot of links, and that will also be in the video, so that you know, anything that you might be missing right now or you didn't get, don't worry about. We'll have that all in the video, contact information, etc. And at the top of the hour here, and I can't believe this went this quickly already, the next hour we're going to spend on talking about some other things about activism and so forth. And we did promise that we would take some calls. So at the top of the hour, be brave. Call in, ask Rosalind your questions, and the number is 347-327-9997. And I know that some people have been calling in. The engineer did let me know. As I had spoken before, we would not be taking those calls into the second hour with, again, our guest, Rosalind Peterson. Now, Rosalind, you mentioned something about the greenhouse gas and melting the Arctic and Alaska areas. You also had mentioned to me why you think they would do such a thing. And of course, I have to ask, why would you want to melt the Arctic? What would be the reason for that, or Alaska?
Well, I put the information, and more documents will go up shortly, but on the Alaska Arctic section of the website, in the category section, I put some of my thoughts about this. And I'm going to put up as many documents as I can find, and the ones within the next 2 weeks or so. But the one of the theories that has gone around for a long time is that if the Arctic and Alaska could be artificially melted or heated up, it would mean that those areas could be exploited for their natural resources. And as frozen areas, totally frozen, they can't possibly get in to exploit those natural resources of those areas. Shell oil, other companies, different countries couldn't possibly get in to exploit those areas. Now what is happening is that those areas are melting. And a Stanford study by Mark Jacobson, and there's others talking about this issue. NASA's talking about it, a CNN program on it, that this area is starting to melt. And Mark Jacobson had talks about the aviation impact of contrails in those areas, warms things up because they leave water vapor. Water vapor is a greenhouse gas, and these jets produce these man-made clouds that traps the heat in, and it's artificially warming those areas to a certain extent. And this has been in Nature magazine, this has been talked about in many areas, as well as on CNN. However, CNN doesn't talk about the reasons, they just talk about the melting. But in a couple of years ago, Charlie Rose, on his show, interviewed the chief head man of Shell Oil. He was very enthusiastic about the melting because they would be able to go into those areas and be able to drill for natural gas and oil and extract other natural resources. And at this time, they're getting permits to drill from the United States and other countries in those areas. They're starting operations because this area has melted. The problem is that if aviation were to go away and if they started to try to cool these areas down, just because they moved aviation away from those areas, they would cool down and freeze over